Welcome. I'm Beth Crow, Executive Director of Development for the Tepper School of Business. We're here today with Mr. Yoshiaki Fujimori. He is the President and CEO of GE Consumer Finance for Asia. He is also a 1981 graduate of the Tepper School of Business, and he is a trustee here at the Carnegie Mellon University. Welcome. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
It's a true honor to speak with you. We're going to talk today about globalization and leadership. We're going to start with outsourcing. So we know that companies reap big cost savings when they outsource to low-cost manufacturing centers in countries such as China. Across Europe and North America, citizens see outsourcing with negative consequences as exporting jobs. At the same time, the offshoring equation is changing for corporations. Rising costs are eroding the advantages, and distant manufacturing operations are stretching supply chains to the breaking points, sometimes in volatile markets. Could you please share your insights on outsourcing, especially as it might relate to Asia?
When we talk about outsourcing, the reason why the corporation, either it's Japanese company or American company, why do they want to do the outsourcing? The reason because it's cost reduction or productivity that can be gained by outsourcing. So the outsourcing fundamentally is to go anybody who can give you a lowest cost. So the next question then is, where do you go? And in many cases, especially for the manufacturing for the low-end product, China is a logical place. Or if you have labor intensive, more than 50%, or you have a totally low-end product, no technology, and just a pure low-end product, then it's better to go to Asia or to go to China or to go to India or to go to Mexico, wherever you can get the lowest cost at an acceptable quality, of course. Mm-hmm. And China, India, Mexico, they're getting quality as good as USA, as good as Japan. Mm-hmm. So, and I don't think there's anything wrong about going outside in terms of quality. Mm-hmm. The only question is cost, how much productivity you can get by doing it. So that's one aspect of outsourcing. Our company GE does a lot of outsourcing. We transfer our manufacturing facility from USA or from Japan to China or to India, mm-hmm. where we don't have much technology differences. Mm-hmm. Having said that, we also go outside of USA, not just because of the low cost, because if the market is in China, mm-hmm. you want to be there. Mm-hmm. Now, if China is growing, we've got to be local. Mm-hmm. And therefore, we've got to manufacture there, we've got to engineer there. Mm-hmm. We have to have a substantial presence in China. Mm-hmm. So it's not just outsourcing, but we move our business mm-hmm. fundamentals to China to be a local player so that we participate in the local market. Mm-hmm. So we do that for the market reason too.
And I know that in India, for example, where they've been doing outsourcing for some time, especially with technology, it's affected a change. So almost culturally in the areas around sort of the big outsourcing centers. So there are women, for example, in India that now are permitted to work at night when they weren't before. There are small villages popping up around outsourcing centers because, you know, there are people working 24 hours a day and they need to eat and all sorts of things. Are you seeing those sorts of things happening, not even outsourcing related, but just in China as, you know, large global businesses move in like GE and are having more and more of a presence?
As we move into China, our business grew like 100% every year, things like that. You know, it's huge growth over there. We employ like almost 10,000, 12,000 people over there. And then we influence not just only our employee, but also the employee's family, employee's related relatives. A lot of people around our employee that we kind of influence the way we do. Mm-hmm. And that's only GE. There are IBM, there are Microsoft, there are a lot of companies going to China. So that really changes the way that they think, of course, and the way they behave, that they the culture-wise, it's going to be a huge impact in the culture. You know, it happened the same thing in Japan a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
Our culture has changed a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And India the same way. So it gets more globalized. You know, we not only influence a USA culture or our culture to Chinese or Japanese, we are influenced too.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of blended all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're very respectful to the culture we go in, either it's India or China. And we try to blend all these cultures to be a strong, diversified culture.
Mm-hmm.
You know, GE is one of the company who strongly pushes for the diversity.
Mm-hmm.
Either it's women or African-American,
mm-hmm.
or a global people. We just want to have more diversified team,
mm-hmm.
which we believe is more energy and more excitement and more creativity in that team.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we wanted to do. So the concept of diversity is fundamentally the globalization,
mm-hmm.
And also the better way to get better ideas and creative ideas.
Okay, thank you. On the idea of diversity with globalization, you've got teams functioning in these different cultures. As you say, you've got people on the ground there. How do you keep those teams motivated? How do you manage them? How do you work that across cultures and with some accountability?
Yeah, when you blend it with a lot of people with different background,
mm-hmm.
We need to probably have sort of a common goal.
Mm-hmm.
The people working for a common goal, if that is clearly defined. And that's one way. And the other way also, as we more diversify our culture and people, as we more globalize, I think we need to create sort of GE values. For example, we want to have energy,
mm-hmm.
in people. We want to have more passionate people.
Mm-hmm.
We want people to think about a global mindset. So we push that sort of a GE value to our employee.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have that,
mm-hmm.
No matter where you go, no matter how mix of the different culture and people, we walk towards the one goal,
mm-hmm.
and the one set of GE values.
Okay.
And that's the way to just kind of get all the people in the same direction.
Staying on that, when we think about ethics and leadership, and in the arena of globalization, and even otherwise, how do you manage the ethical balance that is needed to give maximum shareholder value as it relates to operations in foreign countries?
Different level of ethics and different understanding of ethics based upon our culture. And that's, again, that we think it's important to have a common set of GE values,
mm.
common set of GE policy.
Mm-hmm.
So we have very strict policy or a culture which says compliance,
yes.
or integrity.
Mm-hmm.
And integrity is our number one GE values that has to have. Well, actually, the integrity is, it's in here.
Mm-hmm.
But for whatever you do, we do with integrity,
mm-hmm.
or the compliance to the GE policy.
Mm-hmm.
So we have very strict rules. We have a policy saying that one strike, you're out.
Wow.
Very strict rules. And every time that I speak to the Asian people or European people or American people, we just start from the compliance. We start from the integrity.
Mm-hmm. That leads a little bit to some specifics about regulatory environments, because ethics is we hope something that comes from inside of us. But then there's also the environment that tells you what is right and wrong in a business climate. And those regulatory environments, both domestic here in the United States and then abroad, they're changing and they're impacting global operations, whether that's manufacturing or sales, et cetera, distribution. Can you share your insights into the key policy matters as what you believe the key policy matters are now and sort of on the horizon as they impact large corporations such as GE doing business globally?
Yeah, they definitely, in terms of the corporate ethics,
mm-hmm.
in terms of the corporate governance, the anti-corruption, things like that,
mm-hmm.
USA lead the policy. You know, at the end of the day, when we become a local in that country, when we want to play in that country, that we have to follow that rule. Mm-hmm. Although we do a lot of government relations, mm-hmm. a lot of a lobbying to the government to change the law or change the policy that they have, so that we facilitate more a free competition, mm-hmm. as well as the free market. Mm-hmm. But there are some places that they restrict foreign ownership. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they restrict our participation as a business. So we hit all of these walls anytime and anywhere in the country. But I see gradually the environment are changing. The China, they adopted WTO, the India the same way. And we see more free trade, more free competition. Mm-hmm. We can own many of the Chinese industries 100% by us. Mm. There are some restricted areas like banking are still limited, but mm-hmm. they're going to adopt this WTO in the year 2007, even in the banking sector. And the world is becoming more like a free trade, free competition, things like that. It's very much market-based economy that they, most of the countries are going to be.
Tell us about what's happening with your business within GE. What are the exciting things right now, and what are the really exciting things on the future?
I'm currently doing a consumer finance business in Asia. Mm-hmm. Before that, I was the president and CEO of GE Asia, mm-hmm. which fundamentally oversees all of activities mm-hmm. In Asia. Almost half of the revenue of GE come out from outside the USA. Mm-hmm. Asia is the 20%, and Europe is 20 to 25%. Mm-hmm. So Asia is a significant part of GE's revenue, mm-hmm. and it's growing very fast. Today it's in China. 10 years ago it was Japan. Mm-hmm. In future it's maybe India and Southeast Asia. Mm-hmm. But no matter where you pick, Asia is growing. And a significant portion of our gross rate of our revenue. So our consumer finance, you know, GE has six different businesses, mm-hmm. Two big industrial businesses, based on infrastructure mm-hmm. or industrial businesses. Mm-hmm. And then we have a media entertainment like NBC. Mm-hmm. And then we have two big financial services business. One is on a commercial side mm-hmm. and the other one is on the consumer side. And then we have a healthcare business. Now, on GE, half of GE business is on financial services, and half of that is consumer finance. Consumer finance is fundamentally deal with the consumer financial services, like credit cards, like mortgage, like a personal loan, mm-hmm. Things like that. Nature of our business is truly global. We got to go to Japan. We got to go to China, India, Thailand, everywhere mm-hmm. in the country. And we have to play as a local player mm-hmm. to serve the local people mm-hmm. for the financial needs.
Mm-hmm. Do you have the name recognition for this segment of your business in Asia? In the United States, you know, GE, everybody knows GE, and everybody knows there's GE Finance. But do you have that kind of same name recognition?
No. That's a very good question, actually. That's a challenge for us. Uh-huh. In the USA, GE is probably one of the highest brand. In Asia or in Europe, GE is not the highest brand, mm-hmm. the highest recognized brand. Therefore, we say GE finance business or GE consumer finance business, we don't have a brand. Mm-hmm. Same in Japan either. So that's a challenge for us. Mm-hmm. Because the consumer product is all about brand. Some bank has brand, mm-hmm. like HSBC, Citi, Standard Charter. Mm-hmm. Those company has a brand, mm-hmm. but we don't. So we kind of employed a strategy mm-hmm. to name our brand. Mm-hmm. So we started our brand. It's called GE Money. If it's a bank that we operate, mm-hmm. we call GE Money Bank. Mm-hmm. If it's a retail bank that we operate, it's called GE Money Retail Bank. Mm-hmm. We just celebrated 1 year anniversary of our brand. The GE Money is the brand that we'd like to advertise all over the world.
Let's just switch a little bit to leadership and ask you just a couple questions about leadership. So I want to start with your own personal success story. If you could pinpoint a few experiences that helped to shape you to be a leader, good experiences and bad experiences, what would you share with us?
There are three occasions that I say it was a very good experience that gave me type of the leadership that I have right now. One is, no question, it's Carnegie Mellon, the experience that I had in the Carnegie Mellon. I was a Japanese student and graduate from the Japanese school, very good school, but it's no sense of English. So when I joined the company, the Japanese company, I was ranked like last of the last in the English class. I was just terrible. I couldn't communicate even. But the company was generous enough to sponsor me to get to any business school in the United States. And I happened to be in a CMU. And at that time, there was only a few Asians in the school. It's dominated by Americans. And I was overwhelmed. And things that I experienced in the school, not only the curriculum and the content, but the facing with the people that I never thought better than me. You know, I mean, I'm a Japanese. So long as I'm in a Japanese environment, I'm like the always number one. But I was totally beaten when I was here. Don't understand much of what they say and don't socialize much in the first few months. And it looked like all of them are better than me. So, and I tried to compete myself with them. You know, that was a significant the challenge myself to get familiar. So I told myself, I'll just overcome this for 2 years. And I spent a lot of time. I spent 16 hours of study every day. And I tried to socialize as possible. And I tried to understand them as much as I can. And that was a hell of an experience in the sense that it gave me confidence that I can deal with different environment. And also, you know, when I make an effort, I can have them understand me. And when we understand each other, then it's not just a language capability. It's more like a communication. And I got a lot of confidence. But, you know, again, seeing the people who I think are better than me and try to copy them and try to beat them. That was a great experience that I have in this Carnegie Mellon. And a second is that I went to back Japan and stayed for the same company for a few years, maybe 4 or 5 years. And then I joined a GE a long time ago, but I joined GE after all to American company. Not because that I graduated from a business school in the USA, because I wanted to challenge myself in the bigger league. So I wanted to be in the USA. I wanted to compete with the Americans in American background playgrounds. It took about a few years before I was assigned a business in the USA, business leader in the USA. I was a small business leader, but my boss at that time was very bold enough and trusted me enough that he gave me a global assignment to run the business globally with the profit and loss responsible, what we call P&L responsibility, that has all elements in it, manufacturing, engineering, sales and marketing, and for the Japanese, who has no experience to manage more than a few people, and no experience in the USA, no experience in the technology that we had at that time. It was a hell of a challenge. It's a very, very tough challenge. I had a good actual experience in terms of sales and manufacturing. You know, I learned everything, you know, so fast. But I think the way and how I learned all these things so fast is when I look back and I couldn't do it without experience that I had in the Carnegie Mellon. Then I got a next job, which I thought was impossible for any kind of Japanese to get. And the more I work in GE, the more I work through GE process, I was convinced that the GE has a process and system that treat the people fair and open, no matter where you're from, no matter what your background is. Mm-hmm. And it's just such an environment that I just think that GE has. Mm-hmm. And I was lucky that I have somebody who bet on me. Mm-hmm. And I was lucky that I have a system that evaluate me in the same way that they evaluate everybody else. So, you know, it was so lucky. Mm-hmm. And the third is you know, the leadership challenges come from job experience. I had a bigger job, I get an officer of the company. Every time I get promoted, I get more challenged, mm-hmm. more stretch goals. Mm-hmm. But I manage through all these things and manage the global people. The more experience that I had, different job assignments, strict job assignment, mm-hmm. is the best actually to train you, mm-hmm. Your leadership as well.
What I'm hearing you say is leadership, when you're thinking about, when anyone out there might be thinking about how to build their own leadership skills and looking at how you've done it, you've never shied away from pretty big challenges. You persevered. You were very competitive. And ultimately, you know, you've been taking these leaps, and you say it's because people bet on you. Of course, you've proven yourself. So now you're in a position where you have many people underneath you. When you're deciding which people you're going to take a bet, yeah, who are you going to take that chance on? What are the qualities that you're looking for in those folks to be tomorrow's leaders?
I was given a chance, and this is the time that I give a chance to the people. The GE system is such that we evaluate the people based upon a leadership value that mm-hmm. they have and also the performance they have. I was on the map of the leadership mm-hmm. and the performance. So I was not given an opportunity unless I was in that good value, good mm-hmm. performance category. Mm-hmm. And I always look at those people that work for me or the walk in the environment, say, who are the top 20 or top 10% that we can bet on? Mm-hmm. And this is not just myself. Mm-hmm. We, as a team or a management team, decide who has the good values and who has good performance and who are the top corner of value and performance. Mm-hmm. And once we identify those people, and then we give them a chance. Mm-hmm. The leadership always comes from a stretch assignment. Mm-hmm. So we design those top 10, top 20% of the people, what they do next mm-hmm. as a stretch assignment. And that's what I always do. Mm-hmm. And I always ask my people to do the same thing. So first of all, I got to look at the people. Mm-hmm. Every time I go Asia or US, everywhere, that increased the chance of meet the people. I think it's my obligation that I have to look at the people, I have to communicate with the people as much as I can. Mm-hmm. And then we have a fair assessment of the people mm-hmm. together with my colleague and then identify those people and give them a chance. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of process I just rigorously do mm-hmm. for the sake of our employees, for the sake of their future.
Wonderful. Mr. Fujimori, this has been a real delight. Thank you so much for taking time to talk with us.
Great talking to you.
Thank you.